Well, thank you for the very kind introduction. I hope I don't let your sons down. I must say, in thinking about this talk, I wondered too how I'd ended up being in this cool position of when parents sit to me in clinic and say, I'm really worried my children play the games too long. And I say, if you want them to be clever, if you want them to move well, let them play the games. And so today I'd like to take you through my journey from the early days when I started research in Oxford to today, to how I ended up setting up a company whose purpose is to make it possible for medicine to derive the benefits from games and deliver it to patients who need rehabilitation. So my journey started more than 30 years ago at a seminal time, I think, in Oxford, when neonatal intensive care was being pioneered. It was very early days. At the same time, and we might say this is very bad timing, that gynecologists were experimenting with fertility. And for a critical 2 to 3 year period, we had regular multiple deliveries. 4, 5, 6, 7 babies, all born very prematurely, all at once to the same mother. They'd all experienced the same uterine environment. They all had intensive care. And this was the first group of 4 beautiful babies that I was involved in, all a multiple pregnancy. When they went home, they all looked the same. They all behaved the same. And yet, my experience with these multiple births was that over time, one or two of these children slowly and relentlessly developed cerebral palsy. It took a long time. It may be 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 months before you knew that they had cerebral palsy, and yet the injury had occurred at or around the time of birth. Now, in adulthood, if you had that injury, your worst problem would be at the time that it occurred and you recover. Whereas these children, over the subsequent 20 years, relentlessly developed a movement disorder which was very difficult for them. And I wondered why. Why couldn't I tell at the time of discharge that one or other of these babies, though I must say none of these babies did develop cerebral palsy, was going to develop cerebral palsy? And in reading around it, I was amazed how little we knew about brain development. But this slide here, and it's actually missing, I'm not quite sure why, one bit of it, but I can talk around it. There was a paper in Nature which started this research. And basically, this is the slices of brains from newborn rats, and this rat is P3. Ah, perfect. How did you manage that? It's magic. Okay, so this is the paper that absolutely set me off. It excited me and terrified me at the same time. These were neonatal rats, and in this experiment here, dye was placed in the motor pathways that control movement down near the spinal cord, and it was allowed to wait three days, and then you look to see which neurons fed information to that pathway. Where did that pathway arise? And what they found was that this pathway arose from the whole of the motor cortex. This is day 3, if you looked at day 0, the whole of the motor cortex, front to back, side to side, or the whole of the cortex, fed information down to the spinal cord. Then if you looked in adulthood, if you looked at adulthood, and so if you injected at P28, you found that the pathway arose from only a very selected area of the motor cortex, of the cortex, which we call the motor cortex. This process took a long time, so this is a near adult rat, and yet to full adulthood, this process still continued. There was absolutely substantial reorganization of the information which controlled movement that occurred throughout development. And it wasn't because neurons died. These neurons here didn't die. Because if you injected the dye at birth and then waited for 30 days and looked at the same time as you looked here, these neurons were still alive. What they'd done is chosen to withdraw their projections to the motor control, and they were controlling something else. Now, these experiments also showed that this wasn't just genetically determined. That if you change the environment in which the rat grew up, if you change their movements over a relatively short period, you could completely disturb this. So, for example, if you just restrain the limb of a rat for a relatively short period, early on in development, you totally disrupted the way the brain addressed that movement. Now that excited me because it meant we could possibly control the processes of development which may be going wrong. But it also terrified me because in those days, ventilators were primitive and we paralyzed babies to ventilate them. If they had drips, we stopped them moving their arm for the days they had the drip. That was the equivalent of what you did to a rat when you restrained their limb and totally disorganized their brain control. So for the first time, I thought, I'd taken an oath, first do no harm. Am I doing harm? And how do I know what harm I'm doing and what harm should I stop doing? So my next question was, were these experiments relevant to men? And this is another young man who is now actually sitting his GCSEs. He's been involved in a series of experiments, and I owe this family and this boy a lot of gratitude. But he was referred early to me with a rather skeptical letter that said, his dad's a nurse, his mum's a nurse, and they think there's something wrong with their son. Please see and reassure. Well, shall I show you what his scan showed? This was his MRI scan, and for those of you not familiar, this is normal brain tissue, and he had nearly lost most of one hemisphere in a neonatal stroke. Now, we now know that the first 2 days, 3 days after birth is the most high-risk time ever in your life for a stroke, and it has major implications. Now, here he is taking part in our research, and those of you who know will know that this side of the brain controls this hand, and this side of the brain controls this hand, and this is the side of the brain which was showing less good control of movement and led to the parents, when he was just a small baby, asking if I could see him. Now, when he moves this hand here, it's controlled by this side of the brain, and this is a mapping technique that we have to look at movement, which part of the brain is controlling movement in very young children. And you can see this area of the brain, which is this area here, which is the normal motor cortex, was controlling movement on this side. What absolutely staggered us was here. When this boy moved this hand, which if you and I had had a stroke like that, we'd be totally paralyzed, and he walks and plays games, drives a car, was being controlled, and with our experiments later, we were able to show that it was being controlled by the visual cortex. Now, this is a sensory processing area, and it had become an output control area. And this is because, I'm sure, these parents had started from a very early age being aware that this side needed extra stimulation, extra help. And therefore, the projections which early on went from that area of the brain to the spinal cord were preserved and converted that area of the brain into a motor cortex. So he really confirmed, and a series of other studies confirmed the relevance of what we were seeing in the results of animal experiments were relevant to man. That the brain is plastic, and that the environment can actually change how the brain develops. And equally, you can do harm. And probably in early days in neonatal intensive care, we were definitely doing harm unknowingly. Now, for those of you who are over 25, this is going to be an upsetting slide, and I apologize. This is the map again of the area of the brain that's involved in a child age 10 doing the simple pincer grip, which is what makes us who we are, probably how we control tools. Now, well, actually, this slide won't upset you, it's one to come. This is adulthood, 25-year-olds. Look at the gestalt of this, beautiful, beautiful. This is just second-by-second control using our mapping stick. Tight area of the brain, always controlling this movement versus this very diffuse control here. So, it takes a long time. This is a child of 10, and this is an adult. There was a long time. Could we intervene? Could we start with children with a problem and changing their environment changed their path for cerebral palsy? And so this is a child here. Hopefully it'll start. This is one of a group of children that were involved in a study where we asked a very simple question. If we could change how they played, could we change the control of their hand? Now, if you see here, this child has also had a stroke. And this hand here is held back a lot of the time. She's very able with it. But here, if you see, she uses this hand always in preference to pick something up which she should have used this hand for. The hand is often not in the play area and not used. A very able hand, but not used. And I can tell you, if that continued, she would lose the ability to use that hand progressively through to adulthood. Now, what we then did was that we set up a sort of a primitive gamification. We had a room with lots of toys. We gave her a plastic bag, and we said, you go and pick 10 toys that you'd like to take home. And we said to the parents, you must play these toys with her half an hour, 5 days a week, but it must be competitive. You must make her want to win. You mustn't punish failure too much, and you must reward success. And the games all required playing with two hands. So over 3 months, that's all we did. And this is what she looks like 3 months later. See how that hand is already in the play area straight away? This is just 3 months of play. No therapy. And there's a minute you'll watch as she actually catches in preference with that hand. There was a substantial change in just this hand being involved in everyday life. And I can tell you, this hand being involved in everyday life not only changes how you wire up that hand, but it sets up the pathways where two hands work together. And most things we do in everyday life require two hands working together. The important things, doing up zips, filling your duvet. See? So this was just simple gamification of play, her choosing what she wanted to play with, and parents being very informed. Just normal everyday activity changed. So, why might play actually make this effect? And what we now know is that if you are enjoying, if you're having fun, if you're motivated, if you're mildly competitive and you're focusing on the task, you enjoy it. And enjoyment is the sign that there are chemicals in your brain which make your brain ready to learn. They're chemicals that will increase synapses, that will reorganize your brain to carry out the task that you really enjoy doing. And so the statement, use it or lose it, I'd like to modify and say, love it or lose it. And so was this a special situation in children, we asked ourselves? Or could it also apply to adults? Now this is the slide that'll upset you. This is a 10-year-old, a 25-year-old. This is a 30-year-old, a 50-year-old, and an 80-year-old. And so over time, this beautiful gestalt, this well-organized motor system, becomes disorganized again. Now, is this inevitable? Do we inevitably have to have this poorly controlled motor system? And I would like to challenge you to say no. Whenever we started our research and compared older people with younger people, we found the adult brain was plastic, and it responded very readily to any situation where we were looking for plasticity. So why was this occurring? Why were the pathways that we use for motor control not being reinforced and stabilized and remaining there? We all walk every day. We use knives and forks. We do these things. Why do we lose this control? And I would like to put to you that the reason we lose it is that children play. And they are reinforcing these movement pathways with fun and joy and excitement, whereas I trudge to work. I wash the dishes with some degree of chagrin because my kids haven't done it. And most of our activities of everyday life, we don't enjoy. We've forgotten the importance of play. Now, is that something, again, which is a natural thing? And what I found is that if you put people in a position where they can play, adults do play and enjoy playing. There really isn't much difference. This is a play park built in Manchester for adults. These were not asked, these are just random shots taken. Can you see much difference here between this and that? What about this? Between this and that? Adults will play if we forget all the important things in our lives, like jobs and cleaning the house, and give ourselves the opportunity to enjoy what we're doing. It's also no lover of class. And here, which person do you think is most enjoying it? I rather suspect she is. These are not staged photographs. This is the one I love best. These are people filming themselves playing games. Just look at that. The joy. I bet you she's just beaten him. What do you think? And she's reinforced a very important pathway of motor control, I'm sure, in doing so. He has clearly beaten the game. So I question whether some of the deterioration is because we've forgotten the importance of loving what we're doing, and that we've forgotten that children play every day and we don't. Now this is our attempt to bring play into rehabilitation, to create the situation where the game is where the game induces joy, fun, and what gamers call flow. And I think this video is the best example I've ever seen of flow. He was the first patient we ever tried our game on. He's an ex-drummer in Newcastle. He never had used a computer before when he started this. And his stroke had unfortunately led him not to be able to initiate or sustain movements. And for a drummer, that was dreadful. And he was very sad about this. And what I'd like you to look at is the flow and the smoothness and the complexity of the movements he can demonstrate while playing this game. Now, we got a professional studio to build the game because flow is not easy to do. It's a creative, very difficult task. And there's a picture here in a moment, which I think is the absolute archetype of flow. He's engrossed, he's enjoying it, he's winning. Now this is not staged. When he finishes, which he does in a minute, I want to show you the degree of his difficulty in moving. He can't initiate movements. Put him in a situation like that and suddenly the flow created what we needed to see. Now, does this translate, or does he just play games and then he goes back to being that? The next video I'd like to show you is showing you the effects. This woman here, she was first, before her stroke, she was left-handed. So this hand here, which she's having great difficulty even bringing onto paper, this is before she started playing the game. We just asked her to draw a line on a piece of paper. Now this is a month later.
Pencil and ruler to draw a line across the full width.
Can I use my
the paper?
Now, she's beginning to use a previously dominant hand. We haven't asked her, this is just spontaneous. But she still had to use her other hand to assist her previously dominant hand. Okay. Now this lady had had a stroke years before. You would not expect any improvement like this without it. And this, and we're seeing this regularly now, is what really excited us. There. She's using her hand to pick the pencil up and using it as a dominant hand. She'd changed hand dominance. In a period of 8 weeks, where she played this game, maybe for 20 minutes a day, for about 3 or 4 days a week. So, I think we can get too serious in our lives. I think we have to stand back and we have to think about fun and joy and enjoyment. And when we're facing people like Stephen, who's had a stroke, who's faced death, who's depressed, who's facing his own disability that he'd never had before, the most important thing we can perhaps inject into their lives is fun and joy and create a situation where the brain is biochemically able to learn.
And so, physio environment, I've had a great deal of.
I wonder if you could play that again a bit louder. This was a spontaneous statement he made when we'd been given an award and he was being interviewed, not by us. And what he says is,
never. And for the first time in any sort of physio environment, I've had a great deal of.
He says fun, I promise you. And he did say it every time I read it through. And that was something that gave us great joy. This was a spontaneous remark of his. And so, what I would like to say, this is what we should be trying to achieve when we're doing rehabilitation. Not the serious event where you drive into clinic, where you feel disabled, where the event of the rehabilitation is to try and make you better from something you hate having. Let's get them into a field of love and joy and excitement and flow. And that's the situation where the brain is happy to learn. Thank you very much.